Hello students, today we are going to discuss in a soft topic motion in a plane. In this, firstly we will have information regarding classification of physical quantities as scalars and vectors. After that we discuss motion in a plane idea. So first, any quantity that can be measured and expressed in terms of numerical values is known as physical quantity. Physical quantities are mainly classified into three types: scalars, vectors and tensors. First, scalars. The physical quantities having only magnitude are called scalars. Example: distance, speed, area, volume, mass, etc. Then physical quantities having both magnitude and direction and that obey vector laws of addition are vectors. So this you need to note clearly. Not only having magnitude and direction, but also they should obey the vector laws of addition, then only they will be called as vectors. There are some quantities like electric current which have both magnitude and direction, but they will not be obeying vector laws of addition. That is why they are treated as scalars. An example for vectors are displacement, velocity, acceleration, so on. Then third type of physical quantities, tensors. Tensors are those quantities with one magnitude in any directions. These do not obey the laws of vector addition. That means in different directions also the magnitude would be the same. In example for such are moment of inertia and stress, etc. Then in vectors there are two types, different types of vectors called axial vectors and polar vectors. Vectors which have some starting point or point of application are called polar vectors. For example, displacement, force. Then, but those vectors representing rotational effects and are always along the axis of rotation in accordance with right hand screw rule are axial vectors. Means the vectors which will be always acting along the axis of rotation and their directions are given by right hand screw rule, they will be called as axial vectors. Example for axial vectors are angular velocity, angular acceleration, angular displacement, torque, so on. Then an important type of vector is unit vector. A vector having unit magnitude is called unit vector, and this vector is generally used for adding direction aspect to the vectors. Whenever you want to represent direction of any vector, we'll be multiplying it with its magnitude with unit vector. So thus a unit vector is mathematically given by, if unit vector of vector v dash, vector v bar, if you take, that will be v cap is equal to v bar by mod v bar, or else this mod v bar is called magnitude, so vector by its magnitude will give us unit vector. So where this mod v vector is the magnitude of v vector, and I cap, j cap, k cap are generally unit vectors along x, y and z directions respectively. And modulus of all these unit vectors, that is magnitude of all these unit vectors, is equal to 1. And unit vector along the direction is unique and have no unit. For unit vectors there will be no units, and it will have only a unique direction, means only one direction. Then null vector or zero vector. Null vector or zero vector is a vector with zero magnitude in general, and this will arise in many situations like we have given here. Two opposite vectors added to form a null vector. Means whenever two vectors which are having equal magnitude and opposite directions are added, then the result will be null vector or zero vector. It will have zero magnitude. So if A vector plus B vector is equal to zero, then we can write A vector is equal to minus B vector. That means A and B are two vectors with same magnitude but in opposite directions. Then for addition of vectors we have following rules. Triangle of vector addition. It is stated like, if two vectors are represented as sides of triangle in same order, then the third side in opposite order is the resultant of them. Here we have taken vectors A vector and B vector. If A vector and B vector are two vectors represented as sides of triangle in same order, then the other side C vector in opposite order is the resultant. If you see carefully in the diagram, A vector begins from here and ends here, and from there B vector will begin. That's why they are said to be in same order. Then third vector, the third side of the triangle is taken in opposite order. If you see, if they are in same order, first B vector will start where A vector has ended. Then if C vector is starting where B vector is ended, then it would have been in same order. But here it is in opposite order. This you need to keep in mind. Then parallelogram law of vector addition, one of the very very important ideas of in physics, first PUC as well as second PUC in objective part also. If two vectors having common origin are represented both in magnitude and direction as two adjacent sides of parallelogram, then the diagonal which originates from the common origin represents the resultant of the two vectors. That means if two vectors are starting from same position and they can be represented as two adjacent sides of the parallelogram starting from same point, then the diagonal starting from the same point will be resultant of those two. So if you see in the diagram, we have two vectors starting from same point, A vector and B vector. And also if you complete the parallelogram, this A vector and B vector are representing adjacent sides which are starting from same point. Then R vector is the diagonal of the parallelogram which is drawn from the same point. So this R vector will be resultant of A vector and B vector, or some vector sum of A vector and B vector. That's why in the results we have written R vector is equal to A vector plus B vector, and modulus, there is the magnitude of R vector can be given by the formula mod R vector, that is resultant magnitude, is equal to A square plus B square plus 2ab cos theta power 1 by 2, that is under root of A square plus B square plus 2ab cos theta. Here theta is the angle between A vector and B vector. Then here alpha, that is the direction of resultant with respect to A vector, is given by this angle alpha, which will be expressed as tan alpha is equal to B sin theta divided by A plus B cos theta. If you want to express direction of R vector with respect to B vector, then you should use the angle beta. That will be expressed as tan beta is equal to A sin theta divided by B plus A cos theta. This you need to keep in mind. Then if suppose two vectors are of equal magnitude, that is if A vector, if mod A vector and mod B vector is equal to X, then the resultant magnitude will be always equal to 2X cos theta by 2. That is what, you know, that we have obtained from substitution here, X square plus 2X square cos theta power 1 by 2. X we are taking common, that we are getting X into under root of 2 into 1 plus cos theta, that is like 2x cos theta, 2x cos theta by 2. And if alpha and beta are equal, sorry, here if magnitudes of both the vectors are equal, so alpha and beta will be equal to theta by 2. That means always the resultant will be bisecting the angle between A vector and B vector. Then suppose if A vector is having greater magnitude than B vector, then alpha will be less than beta, and the maximum value of resultant R maximum is equal to A plus B. This will be possible when theta is equal to 0. That means both the vectors are in same direction. And resultant value, minimum value of resultant is modulus of A minus B, or we can take A difference B. This is possible if two vectors are in opposite direction or theta is equal to 180 degree. And R square is equal to A square plus B square if theta is equal to 90 degree. That means if two vectors are perpendicular, then R square is equal to A square plus B square, or R is equal to root of A square plus B square. Then suppose if both the vectors are of same magnitude and also resultant magnitude is same, this is possible only when theta is equal to 120 degree. It means if two equal vectors are having angle of 120 degree between them, then the resultant will have same magnitude as them. This we need to keep in mind. Then if R vector is perpendicular to one of the vectors, say A vectors, if resultant vector is perpendicular to one of the vectors, but say A vector, then cos theta is equal to minus A by B. Cos theta is equal to minus A by B, and also A square plus R square is equal to B square. A square plus R square is equal to B square. This will help us to solve the problems very quickly. Then next, subtraction of vectors. So subtraction of vector is like addition of one vector with negative of another vector. That's why see here we have mentioned subtraction of vector B vector from A vector is simply addition of minus B vector with A vector. it is A vector minus B vector is equal to A plus of minus B vector. So here we are going to use a parallelogram law first. See in the diagram we have A vector and B vector starting from same point. Then here I have to subtract B vector from A vector, that is A vector minus B vector should be found. For that I need to add A vector with minus B vector. So I am drawing the vector of same magnitude in opposite direction to B vector that we got as minus B vector. Then A vector and minus B vector are again representing two adjacent sides of parallelogram. So the resultant is the diagonal starting from the same point. So this will give us the resultant of A vector and minus B vector. A vector and minus B vector. That is nothing but A vector minus B vector. So now on analyzing, we will get R vector value. That is magnitude of R vector. R is equal to root of A square plus B square minus 2AB cos theta. Make this correction. R is equal to modulus of A vector minus B vector, which is equal to root of A square plus B square minus 2AB cos theta. And also tan alpha, that is the resultant direction, the direction of A vector minus B vector with respect to A vector is given by tan alpha is equal to B sine of pi minus theta divided by A plus B into cos of pi minus theta. Sine of pi minus theta is sine theta, cos of pi minus theta is minus cos theta. So we will get tan alpha is equal to B sine theta divided by A minus B cos theta. This you need to keep in mind. And if the two vectors A vector and B vector are of same magnitude, then the resultant magnitude will become 2x sine theta by 2. If two vectors are equal in magnitude, the sum will be 2x cos theta by 2. If the difference will be 2x sine theta by 2. This you need to keep in mind. Then the reverse process of this addition of vectors is called as resolution of vectors. In addition of vectors, we have combined two vectors to give resultant vector or one vector. Then in this resolution process, we can split any vector into number of vectors. So any vector V vector can be represented as sum of two vectors P vector and Q vector, which are in same plane, as V vector is equal to lambda P vector plus mu Q vector, where lambda and mu, this printing mistake you need to correct, lambda and mu are two real numbers. Then let V vector has been resolved into two components, component vectors lambda P vector and mu Q vector along P vector and Q vector respectively. Then so here this is V vector, this its component along x direction is Vx vector, which you can write as lambda P vector. That means it is parallel to P vector along this direction, but having different magnitude. And this is Vy vector, this is Y component, which we expressed here as mu Q vector. That means it is parallel to a vector along this direction, which is Q vector. And in general, the relation between these components will be expressed like this if they are along two perpendicular directions like these two. When two vectors are taken, when two components of the vector are along two perpendicular directions, they will be called as rectangular components. You can have infinite components for a vector, this you need to keep in mind, but the most important ones are rectangular components. That's why here in two dimensions, if we are having a vector in a plane, then the two dimension, then the rectangular components will be given like this. In terms of rectangular components, V vector is equal to Vx vector plus Vy vector, and this Vx vector will have magnitude of Vx, and the direction is along x-axis as per the diagram. So we have included I cap unit vector, and then Vy vector has magnitude of Vy, and it is along j cap direction. This here vector form should not be there; it should be just Vx I cap plus Vy j cap. Make that modification, and the in magnitude V is equal to root of Vx square plus Vy square. This you need to keep in mind. And here Vx is equal to V cos theta, Vy is equal to V sin theta, and there is no component along z direction, that is Vz is equal to 0. And we can write V vector also as V cos theta I cap plus V sin theta j cap. This you need to keep in mind. Then multiplication of two vectors. Multiplication of two vectors can be done in two ways. The result can be either a scalar or vector. If multiplication of two vectors is resulting in a scalar, it would be a scalar product or dot product. If multiplication of two vectors is giving us a vector, it will be called as vector product or cross product. Here in a comparative manner, we can study this. see here the mathematical formula. Mathematically, the dot product is expressed as a vector dot b vector is equal to mod a vector into mod b vector into cos theta. That means dot product of two vectors is equal to product of magnitudes of two vectors and cosine of angle between them. Then this product is a scalar quantity. This you need to keep in mind. In vector product, the mathematical form of vector product is a vector cross b vector is equal to mod a vector mod b vector sine theta into n cap. So here n cap is representing the direction of a vector cross b vector. That is, it is a vector quantity, and its magnitude is equal to product of magnitudes of a and b and sine of angle between them. This you need to keep in mind. And if you see here, scalar product a vector dot b vector is equal to b vector dot a vector. That means it obeys commutative property. But a vector cross b vector is equal to minus b vector cross a vector. That means the cross product of vectors is not commutative. Then a vector dot b vector plus c vector is equal to a vector dot b vector plus a vector dot c vector. This is distribution. This distributive property. So dot product is distributive over addition. Then in case of cross product, a vector cross b vector plus c vector is equal to a vector cross b vector plus a vector cross c vector. So this is also distributive property. So cross product also is distributive over addition. Then if suppose a vector and b vectors are parallel or anti-parallel, that means parallel and anti-parallel, that means if theta is equal to 0 degree or in the same direction, theta is equal to 180 degree or in opposite direction. Parallel means two vectors are in same direction, anti-parallel means two vectors are in opposite direction. In that case, we'll get a vector dot b vector when they are in parallel is equal to mod a vector into mod b vector. When they are in anti-parallel directions, mod a vector dot b vector is equal to minus a mod b. Now if in case of cross product we consider, if two vectors are parallel or anti-parallel, then cross product is equal to zero. Then in case of scalar product, if two vectors are perpendicular, then that product is zero. But in case of cross product, the if two vectors are perpendicular, the cross product will have result of a vector cross b vector is equal to mod a vector mod b vector into n cap. Then the cross product of two vectors which are in component form can be expressed as a vector dot b vector is equal to ax bx plus ay by plus az bs. That means if two vectors are expressed, a vector is equal to ax I cap plus b ay j cap plus az k cap, and b vector is equal to bx I cap plus by j cap plus bz k cap, then the dot product can be expressed like this. Then cross product can be found by using this determinant function. A vector cross b vector is equal to determinant of I cap, j cap, k cap, ax, ay, az, bx, by, vz. This we need to elaborate, expand to get the answer. Then in previous chapter we studied regarding relative motion in one dimension. Now here we are having a discussion about relative motion in two dimensions. So we already know that velocity of object A with respect to B is VAB vector is equal to VA vector minus VB vector, and VBA vector is equal to VB vector minus VA vector. And here the next part is rain umbrella problem, direction in which a person has to hold umbrella when it is raining. That we need to discuss here. Consider a person moving on a straight road and has to hold his umbrella opposite to the direction of relative velocity of rain. Means when as the rain is falling and body person is moving, the person has to hold umbrella such that he is protected from rain. In this case, even though rain is falling vertically, he cannot protect himself by holding the umbrella in vertical direction, but he has to hold it opposite to the relative velocity of rain with respect to him. So that is velocity of rain with respect to man. Here we are written it as VRM vector, velocity of rain with respect to man. So velocity of man is in forward direction and velocity of rain is in downward direction. Now velocity of man is towards right, but we want VRM vector, which is equal to VR vector minus VM vector. So we are drawing VM minus VM vector here opposite to VM vector. VM vector is towards right, minus VM vector is towards left. So now VR vector and minus VM vector, they are forming two sides of triangle in same order. So the third vector in the opposite order will become the resultant. So this is the resultant of that. That is VRM vector. That is relative velocity of rain with respect to man. So in the opposite direction to this, the man has to hold the umbrella. So this theta is the direction in which the person has to hold the umbrella, which is tan theta is equal to Vm divided by Vr, where Vm is magnitude of velocity of man or simply speed of man. Vr is speed of rain. So with vertical direction, the person should make an angle, the direction of holding of umbrella should make an angle theta such that tan theta is equal to Vm by Vr. This you need to keep in mind. Then next, next one is closest approach. So if two objects A and B are having velocities VA vector and VB vector at separation x as shown in figure, then the relative velocity of approach, the relative velocity of A with respect to B is equal to VAB vector is equal to VA vector minus VB vector, and tan beta is equal to VA by VB. Right. Then crossing the river is one of the important aspects in objective exams. So to cross a river, to solve these problems, let us consider V is the velocity of man in still water and theta is the angle at which the man swims with respect to normal to the bank, such that as we are seeing, the man is swimming in this direction. So this will have two components for this velocity. So velocity along x direction is minus v sin theta, velocity along y direction is v cos theta. That is why vx is equal to minus v sin theta, vy is equal to plus v cos theta. So now the time taken by the person to cross this river will be equal to distance covered or the width of the river divided by vertical component of his velocity, that is t is equal to d divided by v cos theta. And then velocity along the river for this person, velocity along the river for this person, vx dash is equal to u minus v sin theta, u minus v sin theta. Here u is velocity of the river flow, velocity of the river flow. And then as a person is reaching this other end, there will be a drift. So the drift along the river, that means he is actually supposed to reach over here, but if he starts swimming in this direction, he will be ending at this point. That is, some distance is moved along the direction of river flow, so that is called as drift here. That drift along the river flow is equal to vx dash into t. So d is equal to drift, d capital D is equal to d into u minus v sin theta divided by v cos theta. Then the minimum time to cross the river is given by t minimum is equal to d by v. This is possible if theta is equal to 0 degree. That means if the person is directly swimming along the normal direction to the river flow, then we'll have the person crossing the river in minimum time. That will be given by d by v. Then in that case, the drift will be capital D is equal to small d into u by v. Then to cross the river straight, that means the person has to exactly reach the opposite point on the river bank. Then in that case, there should be no drift at all. That means d is equal to 0. So if you take d is equal to 0, then u minus v sin theta must be equal to 0. From that we can get sin theta is equal to u by v. And here we have to, this is possible when v is greater than u. And in that case, time taken by the person to cross the river is t is equal to d divided by v cos theta, which can be also expressed as d divided by root of v square minus u square. Then in motion in a plane, we are having an important idea called projectile motion here. So any object which is moving in space under the influence of gravity is called projectile. And in projectile motion, there are two kind of projectiles in general in discussion. One is horizontal projection, one is oblique projection. So first we discuss horizontal projection. A body of mass m is projected horizontally with a speed u from a height h at the moment t is equal to 0. See here, you are seeing here from ground at a height h there is a body at t is equal to 0 and it is projected in horizontal direction, means its velocity is completely along x direction. Then the path followed by this object will be a parabola and it hits the ground at a distance capital R from with respect to this point of projection in time capital T and it reaches the ground with a velocity v vector. And in this case capital T is given by the formula root of 2h by g. This is also called as time of flight. T is equal to root of 2h by g, and the final velocity with which the body reaches ground is equal to root of u square plus 2gh, or also you can write this in terms of time, ui cap plus gt cap is equal to gt j cap is equal to v vector, or mod v vector is equal to modulus of ui cap plus g capital t j cap and modulus. Then the position of the body at any instant t naught in between is given by the formula x is equal to u t naught. That means from this reference position along horizontal direction, the distance would be x is equal to u t naught. In this direction, there will be no acceleration acting on the body, but in a vertical direction, the body is experiencing horizontal direction. So y, the vertical distance the body has covered, will be given by y is equal to half into g t naught square. Or else you can also express this in terms of x, or by substituting this t naught formula. From x is equal to u t naught, in this we get y is equal to g x square divided by 2 u square. This equation can be also called as equation of trajectory. Trajectory is generally path followed by the body, and here these things we need to remember regarding horizontal projection. Then oblique projection. So a body of mass m projected from the ground with speed u at an angle theta above the horizontal at moment t is equal to 0. Here we are mentioning it as oblique projection because the direction of initial velocity of the body is oblique to the direction, horizontal direction. It is making an angle theta with horizontal. In this case, the body travels again in a parabolic path and reaches the ground. The total time for which the body is in flight is called time of flight, and that is given by t is equal to 2 uy by g. Here uy is vertical component of initial velocity, which is u sin theta. So capital T is equal to 2 u sin theta by g. And here the time taken by the body to reach the maximum height where this uy will become zero. That means, vy will become zero. That means the vertical component of velocity will become zero at this position. That position is called as maximum height at this position. So as the body moves from here to here, the vertical component of velocity decreases and finally it becomes zero at this position. That maximum height is given by the formula h is equal to uy square by 2g, which we can get as u square sin square theta divided by 2g. And the time taken by the body to reach the maximum height from the point of projection is called time of ascent, which will be equal to half of the time of flight. And in the absence of air resistance, the body takes the same amount of time to reach the ground from maximum height. That is called as time of descent. That is also equal to u sin theta by g. So time of ascent and time of descent, both of them are equal, which will be equal to u sin theta by g. And sum of time of ascent and time of descent is called as time of flight, which will be expressed as 2 u sin theta by g. And the horizontal distance covered by the body before reaching the ground is called as horizontal range. It is given by the formula capital R is equal to ux into capital T, and that we can simplify into u square sin 2 theta divided by g, or else you can also write it as 2 ux uy by g. So capital R is equal to ux into t, or capital R is equal to 2 ux uy by g, or capital R is equal to u square sin 2 theta by g. And the equation of the trajectory followed by the particle in oblique projection is given by y is equal to x tan theta minus g x square divided by 2 u square cos square theta. Or if you take x tan theta common on either sides, you can also write it as y is equal to x tan theta into 1 minus x by capital R. And throughout the motion of the body, the horizontal component of velocity will be same. That is why we are writing here horizontal component of velocity after any time t is vx, which is equal to ux. That means final velocity is equal to initial velocity. It is equal to u cos theta. But along the vertical direction, the velocity will be undergoing the change. And hence here, the vertical component of velocity after any time t is equal to vy is equal to uy minus gt, or else we can write it as u sin theta minus gt. So at any time, total velocity, if you want to write, that is v vector is equal to vx I cap plus vy j cap, or else v vector is equal to u cos theta I cap plus u sin theta minus gt into j cap. So if you want to write magnitude of velocity, that is speed of the body at any time, so v is equal to root of vx square plus vy square, that is root of u cos theta whole square plus u sin theta minus gt whole square. And this vector, v vector, is going to make an angle alpha with horizontal, that is tan inverse of vx by vx, that is tan inverse of u sin theta minus gt divided by u cos theta. Then another idea we are going to study is complementary angle of projection. That means complementary angles means two angles, when they are added to give 90 degree, then they are called as complementary angles. For example, theta and 90 minus theta. So when two bodies are projected with same initial velocity but at two different angles of projection, theta and 90 minus theta, then the range is same. That means when two bodies are moving with same initial velocity but having angles of projections theta and 90 minus theta, that is complementary angles, both of them will cover same horizontal distance in the time of flight. And then these are some important results which will save us some time. If you remember, if t1 and t2 are the times of flight for complementary angles of projection, then t1 by t2 is equal to tan theta, t1 into t2 is equal to 2r by g. That means t1 t2 is proportional to capital R. This you need to keep in mind. Then if h1 and h2 are maximum heights for complementary angles of projection, then h1 by h2 is equal to tan square theta, h1 plus h2 is equal to u square by 2g, and capital R is equal to 4 into root h1 h2, and maximum range, R maximum, is equal to 2 into h1 plus h2. Then relation between range and maximum height is 4h is equal to r tan theta. And here, if r is equal to h, suppose if r is equal to h, then theta is equal to, it's a special case, if r is equal to h, then theta is equal to tan inverse of 4, that is 76 degree. That means if a body is projected with 76 degree making and with horizontal, then range and maximum height will be equal. Range and maximum height will be equal, and this we need to keep in mind. Then, if a man throws a body to a maximum distance capital R, then he can project the body to a vertical height of R by 2. Means if maximum horizontal distance that can be covered by body is capital R, the maximum vertical distance it can cover is R by 2. This we need to keep in mind. The angle between velocity and acceleration during the rise of projectile is between 90 degree and 180 degree. Theta is greater than 180 degree. Sorry, theta is less than 180 degree and greater than 90 degrees. Theta is in between 90 and 180 degree. And the angle between velocity and acceleration during the fall of projectile, means during the descent, is between 0 and 90 degree. Greater than 0 and less than 90 degree. Then, the height attained by the particle is largest when theta is equal to 90 degree. In this case, the time of flight is maximum and range is minimum. That means the body will become a vertically projected body. Then the horizontal range is same for complementary angles, as we mentioned, theta and 90 minus theta, or we can also express them as 45 plus theta and 45 minus theta. And range is maximum for theta is equal to 45 degree. And when range is maximum, because we have the relation h is equal to r maximum by 4. The maximum height is r maximum by 4. Then when r is range, t is time of flight, and h is maximum range, then the relation between all of them is tan theta is equal to gt square divided by 2r, or tan theta is equal to 4h by r. Then average velocity of the projectile during the entire journey is total displacement by total time, and total displacement is equal to range, total time is time of flight. So that is u cos theta into capital T divided by capital T. Range is equal to ux into t. Ux is u cos theta. That is why we are writing u cos theta into capital T divided by capital T. Capital T cancels, and average velocity is equal to u cos theta. So average velocity of the projectile, oblique projectile, during the entire journey is equal to u cos theta. Then at highest point of the projectile, kinetic energy is half into m u square cos square theta. That means here it is also equal to et cos square theta. Et is total the total kinetic energy, initial kinetic energy. Initially the body is having velocity u, so half mu square is total kinetic energy in the initial condition. So that they have mentioned it here, it as et, or you can also take it as e naught in another manner. And in this case, the potential energy is given by formula ep is equal to half mu square sin square theta. Half mu square cos square theta is kinetic energy, half mu square sin square theta is potential energy, and this can be also expressed as et sin square theta. So if you add, if you carefully observe here, et cos square theta and et sin square theta, if you add, you will get et as a result. That means sum of the kinetic energy and potential energy is same throughout the motion, and the ratio of potential and kinetic energies is equal to tan square theta, is equal to tan square theta. And during the entire motion of this oblique projectile, the physical quantities which remains constant are acceleration due to gravity, total energy which is equal to half mu square. See, again here they have used a different symbol slightly. It can be actually E naught here also, otherwise you make it ET here. And also the horizontal component of velocity u cos theta. These three physical quantities, acceleration due to gravity, total energy of the body, that is to be more exact, total mechanical energy of the body, and horizontal component of velocity, these will not change during the projectile motion. And the velocities, sorry, the quantities which will change during this projectile motion will be speed, velocity, linear momentum, kinetic energy, and potential energy. Then another type of motion which will be considered as motion in a plane is circular motion. So here an object is having a mass m and moving on a circular track of radius r. So the body is moving along a circular track whose radius is r. At t is equal to 0, it was at position A, and at any moment of time t, it has moved to B. So from here to here, the body has taken time t to move, and then in that process, it has made an angle at center, angle AOB equal to theta. This angle is equal to theta. Then let its speed at this instant be v. So at this position, the body has a speed v, and direction is along the tangent. Always you need to keep in mind the direction of velocity of the body will be along the tangential direction, or tangent to the circle direction in the circular motion. And in small time dt, it is moving to point B dash. Here it should be point B dash, such that the angle B dash OB, this angle is equal to d theta. Here theta is missing, you better write it d theta. Then in that case, the angular displacement vector here, the angular displacement is equal to dt k cap. Here axis of rotation will be perpendicular to the plane passing through this origin. That's why it is directed here along k cap. So dt vector is equal to d theta into k cap. And if you differentiate with respect to time, you'll get angular velocity omega vector is equal to d theta by dt k cap. And here at b dash, the speed is slightly more, which is equal to v plus dv. So speed is changing along the circular path, so there will be an acceleration along this tangential direction. This is known as tangential acceleration. This tangential acceleration at is equal to dv by dt. And along with that, there will be another acceleration when a body is moving along the circle, that is called radial acceleration, because this acceleration is always along the radius, and This is also known as centripetal acceleration because it is always acting towards the center. At any point on this circular path, this body will have an acceleration acting towards this center of the circle and along the radius. That is why it is called as centripetal. And this centripetal acceleration is given by AC is equal to V square by R, or AC is equal to omega square R. And the angular acceleration, if omega is changing, then we'll have angular acceleration, which is given by alpha is equal to d omega by dt. And the relation between these linear and angular quantities is are expressed like this. V vector, that is linear velocity, is equal to omega vector cross r vector. That means linear velocity is equal to angular velocity cross radius vector. Then a vector is equal to dv vector by dt. And we are writing this v vector is equal to omega vector cross r vector. And then continuing differentiation, applying the product rule, you are getting dv vector by dt is equal to omega vector cross dr vector by dt, which will be dr vector by dt, and plus d omega vector by dt cross r vector. So here this omega vector cross dr by dt can be also taken as centripetal acceleration, and d omega by dt cross r vector will be taken as tangential acceleration. So total acceleration of the body can be equal to vector sum of centripetal acceleration and tangential acceleration. This you need to keep in mind. And also the centripetal acceleration can be written as cross product of omega vector and v vector, and tangential acceleration can be written as cross product of alpha vector angular acceleration and r vector radius vector. And here, since the direction of motion of the body is continuously changing along the circular path, the direction of velocity is changing, so momentum also is changing in direction. But if body is moving with constant speed throughout, means without tangential acceleration, then that type of motion is called as uniform circular motion. In that case, that magnitude of momentum will be constant. And then during one complete rotation, the distance traveled by the body is equal to 2 pi r, that is circumference of the circle. So the frequency of rotation, the linear velocity. The velocity is equal to distance, or speed is equal to distance by time, 2 pi r divided by capital T, time period. Then 1 by capital T is equal to frequency of rotation. So 2 pi r into f we get. Here 2 pi f is called as angular frequency or angular velocity. So we will get v is equal to omega r as a relation. V is the speed of revolution of the body. And then as the speed of revolution is constant and v is equal to r omega, so omega also will be constant and the motion will be periodic. Since omega is constant, the relation between time period and omega is t is equal to 2 pi by omega, which also is constant. So that is why the body will be completing revolutions after a particular time again and again. That is why the motion will be periodic, and that will be equal to 2 pi by omega, or we can also write as 2 pi r by v. That's it, students. Thank you.